Thank you so much, Sam. I know you've got ambitions of being a fighter, a stick fighter, or indonga fighter, but I'm with Kgosi here, Kgosi Zibi, and he's thwarted all your ambitions and dreams. He says you must go straight to his visions, and all those disillusions of yours will come to nothing, because there uzohlangana nendanga zakho. You'll see your peers there, and they don't play around. So I see your challenge to Phil, and Phil is not exactly in your age group, so it's easy to make light of it. But when you go to Kgosi Zibi's village, you'll definitely see people who are of your age group there. It's not fun and games. They'll show you flames, those people. But let's turn our attentions now away from the traditional sport that we've been focusing on and that just before the break, and focus on traditional leaders and the role that they play in the society, and whether or not years down the line they are still relevant. It's a key question that is being asked. They've lamented the fact that they've been left out of key and crucial decision-making processes. They've been sidelined and even ostracized in some municipal decisions and some projects that could better service delivery. So just last week, I think it was, just listen to this. Presidential Local Government Summit, therein the kings and the chiefs complained that in some instances there's zero communication from municipal officials. Well, we're joined now by the chairperson of the House of Traditional Leaders, Kgosi Zibi. Dadamolo, thank you so much for joining us. Siyabulela, Kgosi. Dada Khawusixelele, what is the, in fact, before we speak about the role of traditional leaders, because I want to find out from you, I want to first go back to the introduction. Are the traditional leaders, the chiefs and the kings, are they justified in feeling ostracized?
Certainly, they are justified. Remember, traditional leaders have led their people from time immemorial. And unfortunately, the institution has gone through various phases, namely negative ones. Firstly, colonialism, accompanied by the missionaries who came in and gave us the Bible and barrels of brandy. Then came apartheid. Then came the homeland system. Now, people have developed that feeling that traditional leaders have cooperated with the various regimes that I've just mentioned. And they felt that including them in the current dispensation would slow down the process of democratization. And you do feel, you know, unwanted in certain quarters. Although I may say that, or qualify my statement by saying that things are improving. They are not as they were in the past. So there is some light, at least in the tunnel. Yes.
Dada, what is the role of traditional leaders, of chiefs and kings in this dispensation?
Traditional leaders lead. They are leaders of their people. In fact, they are the ones that have to provide guidance as to where, you know, their communities have to go. Traditional leaders apparently have to work with municipalities to identify development projects in their respective villages. There are quite a number of, you know, functions that traditional leaders play, and they are defined in the legislation that governs, you know, traditional leaders, and the Traditional Leaders Governance Framework Act, which is the one that all that governs. Traditional leaders primarily are custodians of the cultures of their various people, and that's one of the most important functions that they carry. Yes.
Do you feel that the culture, the tradition, is seen to the languages are being eroded in our country? And if so, what can actively be done to galvanize and rejuvenate that?
Well, eroded, yes. But I regard it personally as a natural process, that is that of social change. When it comes to culture, we always have to bear in mind that culture is not static. Culture is dynamic. It changes with time. When society or various communities meet, then there is that diffusion and culture changes. Further, culture is used or is of utility when it's still functional. The minute it's dysfunctional, it's thrown overboard. Let me make an example. I'm Hlubi, and we had a system of burying our dead in the afternoons, because a man would say, We didn't have a quarrel with the late, so he's got to be in his house until afternoon and all such things. But with time, people started, they started depending on the wage economy. They had to go and work in the cities. So time was of the essence. Now, this pressurizes you to change to a new system where, for instance, you start burying in the mornings so that people are free to leave and go to work and all such things. So you see that practice, or that cultural practice, has been discarded. And a new one has taken place because it is convenience. It is convenient, it is functional and not dysfunctional.
It's practical.
It is practical, yes. So the issue of culture, people have to be very careful about it because you may be very emotional about the past, but we must remember that culture has to change. However, at the same time, change needs to be managed. For instance, a lot of people say that is why we have youth who have become wayward, because the changes that they are going through are not managed, are not directed at a particular, you know, direction.
They need to be channeled.
They need to be channeled where we desire our young people to go. But if they do things that they like and we say, look, it's time of change, then we are in for a high job in the future.
Tatandibulela kakhulu, thank you so much for having joined us. Let's leave it there. Until next time, enjoy Heritage Day. South Africa, that's just a taste of what's coming up today as we take a closer look at ourselves as a people, at ourselves as individual, and what defines us. We leave it there for now. Ad break. Morning Live continues after this. Stay right where you are.
Thank you.